honor to introduce Robert Trent Pomplun, Associate Professor, Loyola University, Maryland, Department of Theology. And he's done research on the problem of Maria de Agreda's Scotism between the mystical interpretation of Scripture and modern historical criticism.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Father Ed. And first, I'd like to thank the organizers of the conference for including me. I was talking with a couple friars over dinner, and someone said, "Well, how did you come to hear about the symposium, and how were you invited?" And I said, "Well, I work on Scotus theology, but most of my friends are Dominicans and Jesuits. I teach at a Jesuit school, and I'm often the token Scotist in strongly Thomist circles. I guess allow one of us around for loyal opposition." And when I saw the conference, I asked to come just to share the company of a few like-minded people. So I am very grateful. Perhaps it goes without saying, at least in present company, that this is the 350th anniversary of the death of the great Franciscan visionary and missionary to Texas, Sor Maria de Agreda. Although Sor Maria died in the Order of Sanctity in 1665 and was declared venerable by Pope Clement X in 1673, the Mystica Ciudad de Dios soon became the occasion of a long-ranging theological controversy that would come to include and even encompass debates about the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, the status of private revelations in the Church, the nature of theology as a science, and the meaning of the literal sense of Scripture. It continues to provoke controversy. As recently as 1998, the Theological Commission chosen by the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith declared that the presentation of the figure of the Mother of God found in Sor Maria's famous work differed from the presentation found in Holy Scripture and was not compatible with the Mariology developed by the Second Vatican Council. Of course, this charge has been challenged by Father Enrique Llamas in a large article that has since been translated by Father Fehlner and published by the Academy of the Immaculate. It was through Father Fehlner's translation that I became aware of Llamas' work, and then through Father Llamas' work, I came to research some of the controversy on Maria de Agreda. So I offer just a few of my historical speculations about her Scotism and the possible sources in gratitude to Father Fehlner for introducing me to this subject, if only indirectly. Now, I'd like to explore an early chapter in the controversy surrounding Maria de Agreda. It is well known, I suppose at least to aficionados, that the first opponents of the mystical city of God were Thomists and Jansenists who objected to the book Scotism. In fact, as Benito Mendia Lassa and Antonio Artola Arbiza have demonstrated in their own historical research, much of the controversy that surrounded the book, even into the 1740s, concerned whether Sor Maria had been used as a pawn by her Franciscan confessors to advance the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. In fact, she's often accused of not writing the work, but have, you know, in some sense, serving merely as the face of a work that was written by a Franciscan theologian. Now, recently, scholars such as Andres Molina Prieto and Gaspar Calvo Moralejo have denied or minimized the direct impact of Scotus sources on Sor Maria. The scholars of an older generation, however, have placed Sor Maria within the ambit of an impressive array of Baroque theologians.
In the late 50s, Julio Campos addressed the possible influences of Franciscans such as Andres de Funmayor, Juan de la Palma, and Pedro Manero, the Mercedarian Pedro de Ariola, the Cistercian Raimondo Lumbier, and I think this is perhaps most suggestively, the great Jesuit Juan Martinez de Ripalda. Father Angel Martinez Monyux, in two articles in the early 60s, quite rightly placed Sor Maria in the larger Mariological context of the debates about the debitum peccati that swept Spain in the first quarter of the 17th century, and the debates about the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception during the 1630s and 1640s. Father Martinez accordingly addressed the works of Jaws of the Presentation, Luis de Miranda, Juan Serrano, Luke Wadding, Angelo Volpi, and Francisco Guerra, among Sor Maria's contemporaries, and also the great Franciscan Mariologists who followed or defended her, such as Juan Sindin Calderon, Antonio Rodriguez Fejo, Carlos del Moral, Diego Gonzalez Mateo, and Almesius Kick. You know, we have a nice roster, great Scotists here that have been associated with Sor Maria. Father Martinez, drawing upon many of the great Franciscan theologians of his day, and here we think of Parthenius Mingus and, of course, Balich and Pedro Alcantara. Martinez was content to place Sor Maria in these logical theological contexts of the sources I just mentioned, but hesitate to speculate about what sources she might have read. Martinez was confident that she had been influenced by Diego Murillo's Vida y Excelencias de la Madre de Dios. And indeed, most scholars assume that Sor Maria was familiar with such non-scholastic writings. They were quite common in Spain at the time, quite voluminous, but still quite common. With due scholarly caution, Martinez also suggested that Sor Maria might have either influenced or been influenced by the great Franciscan Mariologist Tomas Francis Urrutigoiti. His first suggestion is uncontroversial, his second quite plausible. Both Murillo and Urrutigoiti were from Zaragoza, near Agreda. Perhaps it should be noted, too, that both Funmayor and Manero acknowledged that Sor Maria could read Latin with some skill. In fact, the entire controversy seems to have gotten started precisely because the censors took issue with the scholastic, indeed the scotistic, nature of Sor Maria's revelations. Now, Sor Maria's scotism is nowhere more apparent than in her treatment of the Signorationis, the logical moments of God's decree to glorify creation through the incarnation of the Word. Drawing upon variants of what I suppose we would now call the Ordinatio 3, Distinction 7, Question 3, Ordinatio 3, Distinction 13, Question 1 through 4, and the supplementum to Ordinatio 3, Distinction 19, Sor Maria presents the Signorationis twice in the mystical city of God. In Book 1, Chapter 3, Numbers 31 through 33, she describes how the triune God, decreeing to bestow his perfections upon creatures, first comprehends all things. First comprehends all things through his scientia simplicis intelligentiae. After petitioning the Lord to make known to her the place of the Mother of God in the divine decrees, she alerts her readers that she will divide the order of God's decree into moments or instants, since it is impossible to accommodate God's knowledge to our limited ways in any other way, or limited minds, excuse me, in any other way. She remarks, this knowledge is called the scientia visionis, which constitute the divine ideas or images of creatures that God decreed to call into actual existence. Now, here, just note very quickly, Sor Maria's use of the distinction between God's scientia simplicis intelligentiae and his scientia visionis. This is a fairly rarefied scholastic distinction that you know, almost opens the revelations. We needn't get into too many details about it, but simply to note, well, for lack of a better phrase, it's rather highfalutin. Maybe more to the point, I think this will become important for how we might identify her sources. I'll show you just here in a second. Turning to Book 1, Chapter 4, we find a more elaborate discussion of the Signorationis. Sor Maria, describing how the divine decrees can be divided into logical moments, says, in the first instant, God, knowing his infinite attributes and perfections, desires to communicate himself outwardly. In the second instant, God, desiring to communicate himself outwardly, desires to do so in the most perfect manner. In the third instant, God determines, as the first object of his will ad extra, the incarnate word and all the blessed coeval with him. Now, if I may be allowed a small digression, many 20th century Scotists, such as Alan Walter, interpreted the famous Totus Christus in Repertatio 3:7-4 to mean that had Adam not fallen, Christ would have been glorified totally, soul and body. And in context, that makes perfect sense, because the context of Scotus's discussion is whether Christ or the Word would become incarnate impassibly. So rather than impassible in soul but passable in body, kind of standard distinction, being both comprehensor and viator, quite naturally the context suggests that the totus Christus is, well, Christ in his entirety, body and soul, both impassible, glorified immediately in the first moment of existence. But in the 17th century, one thing that's kind of interesting is they're far more inclined through slightly different means. They don't have this text, which was made available by Bollich, but through a slightly different text, but through a similar sort of reasoning, they think that the totus Christus is actually Christ's head and members. So all coeval with him. Christ, the Blessed Virgin, the angels, all the blessed. Just as a side note, I would note that broadly speaking, Maria tends to follow this tradition, and it's the one I favor. I mean, perhaps out of devotion to Sor Maria. Now, that said, back to the Signa. In the fourth instant, according to Sor Maria, God abundantly blesses the human soul of Christ, decrees that he will be born of a spotless mother, and prepares their eternal abode. In other words, this fourth instant concerns, following Scotus's rigorous application of the logic of final causality, the total glory that redounds to creation on account of the incarnation. Not just the glory of Christ's soul and the Mother of God, but the New Jerusalem, the Holy Mountain, the eternal banquet, the entire abode that has been made for us. In this instant, according to Sor Maria, God decrees the existence of angels to serve Christ and his mother. In the sixth, he decrees humanity, and only afterwards the fall of Adam. So all of this happens before a prevision of the fall, which of course only happens for Sor Maria in this sixth and final logical instant, or logical moment. So just to real quickly, theologically, it means, of course, with complete consistency, that Christ, Mary, indeed, all are predestined to glory before the provision of sin. Not just Christ and his mother, but all. All predestination is, strictly speaking, antiprovisa merita. Now, as with other Scotists, Sor Maria bolsters her argument of the Signorationis with mystical interpretations of the 8th chapter of Proverbs, the first 3 chapters of Genesis, and the 12th chapter of the Apocalypse, among other fairly common Scotistic proof texts. Now, arranging the senior rationes was something of a sport for 17th and early 18th century theologians, both Scotist and non-Scotist. The diversity of such arrangements allows us to narrow the number of possible influences on Sor Maria. The general tendency of the 17th century Franciscans, beginning with Juan de Herrada, continuing on with Filippo Fabbri and Maurizio Centini, was to interpret Ordinatio 3, Distinction 19, to determine when Christ was predestined absolutely as the Glorificator Dei, and provisionally or conditionally as Redeemer. So, in 1645, Bonaventura Belluti, drawing upon these earlier Scotists, synthesizes the Signa in the following manner. In the first instant, God knows himself as the highest good. In the second, he knows all possible creatures via his scientia simplicis intelligentiae. In the third, he wills to manifest his goodness to angels and humanity through the incarnation of the Word. In the fourth moment, he foresees that some will fall in Adam, and then the fifth, he decrees that the incarnate Word will suffer to redeem fallen humanity. Belluti's colleague, the great Maastrichtus, the greatest of Scotists from this era, slightly modifies this order such that God in the fourth moment decrees the diverse manners in which men and angels will participate in the life of Christ, and then foresees the fallen of Adam and the means of redemption in the fifth moment. Like Maastrichtus, Choresmius adds this fourth moment, but then divides Maastrichtus's fifth moment into a fifth and a sixth. The year of Sor Maria's death, Hieronymus Gallus gives a complex sequence of 10 signorationes. So there are lots of different views on this, as you might expect. Now, among the sources mentioned by Father Martinez, Angelo Volpi adopts a fairly straightforward ordering of God's decree ad extra, in which Christ is first predestined absolutely and substantially as a Glorificator Dei. Mary is absolutely predestined with her son. The angels are predestined as her servants. And Adam and Eve are predestined ante previsa merita, and God then foresees the fall of Adam and Christ as a liberative redeemer. Now, we might note here, this view is going to become, Volpi will probably become relatively commonly followed here among Scotists, but we might note that Volpi did not undertake the larger Scotistic project of integrating their master's teacher on the signorationes. In fact, it bears noting that in neglecting to undertake this task, Volpi, despite a vast erudition and a boundless appetite for controversy, did not become embroiled in the inner Scotist controversy concerning whether God knows all possible creatures via his scientia simplicis intelligentiae during the second signum, or whether he knows all of the creatures he will cause to actually exist via his scientia visionis. Now, we need not get embroiled in that controversy, except to note that the two Franciscan theologians who figured prominently in this debate are relevant for our understanding of Sor Maria's own theology. The first, Juan Sindin Calderon, is again uncontroversial. Sindin Calderon, who argued that God knows all possible creatures via his scientia simplicis intelligentiae during the second signum, was a theologian who wrote the definitive theological commentary on the mystical city of God, which was often published alongside the text in the 17th and 18th century. Now, the second theologian, however, is more interesting. His name is Francisco del Castillo Velasco. I believe that Castillo Velasco's De Preservatione Virginis Matris, which was appended to the 1641 edition of his two-volume commentary on Scotus's commentary on the third book of Lombard Sentences. So to give you an idea of the kind of vastness of the Baroque, these treatises, this is a very large two-volume, probably, I'll have to go back and look at the pages, but you know, each is about 800 pages. And that's a commentary on Scotus's commentary on the third book of the Sentences. So it's quite extensive. And then he appends a separate treatise on Mary's preservation from sin, which includes usually, as was common in the treatises at this time, begins with the treatment of original justice. We'll then move on to questions of the Immaculate Conception itself, usually then into the debitum peccati, which is a far more controversial topic at this point, and then finally end with the discussion of the definability of the dogma. And here, I think, with Castillo Velasco, we're really only at most one step removed from Sor Maria. In fact, I think he's quite likely the theologian upon which she based her own division of the ratio, the senior rationis. Now, like Giles of the Presentation or Luke Wadding or any of the other sources suggested by Father Martinez, Castillo Velasco wrote in defense of the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. And, he does this with some confidence. He's writing in 1641, so like many of his brothers, he was inspired by Pope Gregory XV extending Pope Paul V's censure of preaching against the Immaculate Conception to private teaching. So before that, of course, for Pope Paul V, the censure is simply on public preaching against the Immaculate Conception. So Thomas could teach it in their houses, but they couldn't preach it publicly. Well, in 1622, Pope Gregory XV will, in fact, extend that censure even to private teaching. So as in some confidence, Castillo Velasco will quickly condemn Thomas, who condemned the Immaculate Conception as heretical, such as Bandelli or Spina, to heresy themselves. In fact, he doesn't hesitate to class them with Hesuchius and Kenmets and Calvin. He notes that the Immaculate Conception being the common teaching of theologians, he's writing 1641, he thinks it's common at this point, was even defended by Thomas Aquinas in his small commentary on the angelic salutation. So one of the things that's very interesting in this time period is Franciscans. They're actually quite adept at this. They're very good at saying, oh, so you read Cajetan on that. Well, let's see what Thomas says. So they're actually arguing that they're the first to argue that Thomas supports the Immaculate Conception in his commentary on the angelic salutation, because they think that they can use this against the Thomas who have denied it. And you see them doing this with some vigor. He commends Dominicans such as Catarinus, Vigarius, and John of St. Thomas for defending the Blessed Virgin against her Dominican enemies. Now, like most Scotus, Sor Maria included, Castillo Velasco based his arguments for the absolute predestination of Christ and Mary, and by extension, the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception on some of the texts actually people have already mentioned, the 8th chapter of Proverbs, especially chapter 8, verse 22, the first three chapters of Genesis, of course, especially Genesis 3, 14, and 15, and the mystical interpretation of the Psalms and the Song of Songs. Three things, however, give us reason to think that Castillo Velasco is the source of Sor Maria's theology. First, Castillo Velasco distinguished his own ordering of the senior rationis from the typical Scotist view. The typical Scotist view, he thinks, focuses on God's decrees ad extra, such that Christ is predestined absolutely and substantially in the first moment, Mary is predestined absolutely in the second moment, the world is decreed in the third, angels in the fourth, humanity in the fifth, the fall fourth scene in the sixth, and the redemption decreed in the seventh. Now, not everyone agrees with the numbering, but most people then agree with that order. And sometimes they'll integrate one senior into, or one senium into another. But the important thing is that that's a fairly typical order that we see. In fact, as I suppose that there are as many different ordering of the senior as there are Scotists, or almost. It certainly seems like it when you go through these Baroque treatises. But broadly speaking, I mean, this order comports fairly well with the standard views of Fabri, Volpi, Belluti, and Maastricht, the great Italian commentators on Scotus from the 17th century. Now, the difference is that Castillo-Velasco identifies God's decree of a world shared by Christ and his mother as a signum separate from the others. Now, at least in this ordering that he presents as the typical Scotus view, I should clarify that a little bit. Castillo-Velasco himself, however, prefers to present only four signa. In the first, God, knowing his infinite attributes and perfections, desires to communicate himself outwardly. In the second instance, God, desiring to communicate himself outwardly, desires to do so in the most perfect manner via his scientia visionis. In the third instant, God determines as a first object of his will ad extra the incarnate word and all of the blessed coeval with him, including his mother, the angels, and the saints. In the fourth instant, God decrees a world for the blessed and a law for that world. In fact, he doesn't even explicitly mention the prevision of the fall or a conditional decree of Christ as a passible redeemer. I mean, one can imagine that they come in subsequent moments, but he only lists the four. Now, the only difference between this and Sor Maria is that she felt the need to point out that the angels themselves were preserved from sin by the merits of Christ, of course a Dionysian position much beloved by Scotus and defended by Castillo-Velasco himself in a different context. So she adopts the same order, and especially one thing that you don't see as much in the Italian sources but becomes a very big deal in the Spanish Scotus of this time, the importance of the decree of an actually immaculate world. So not just Christ, his mother, all coeval with him, but the New Jerusalem, the Holy Mountain, the communion of the Eucharist. So most of these figures also think that the Eucharist would exist in Eden, except that blood would not be shed. It would just be shared mystically, as it is, in fact, now, glorified blood, glorified in the first instant. And she follows Castillo-Velasco here. Now, secondly, you might have noted that she also repeats his minority position, which locates God's scientia simplicis intelligentiae in the first signum and his scientia visionis in the second. Now, that's a far rarer position. So it's interesting that she implies that and Castillo-Velasco is one of the few of that time that does. Now, finally, let me say that this is merely circumstantial. Of course, I offer it as kind of historical speculation. But there's one last bit of historical detail that I think is very interesting, and I wanted to present this, just in case anyone knows a little bit about this, is in Castillo-Velasco lists, he gives a history, which was quite common at this time, of the debate, including most of its nuances. And he doesn't hesitate to kind of give a list of his own teachers and the ex professo treatments that he read. And what's particularly interesting is that when he treats the definability of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, he lists as a final influence on his own teaching one Juan de Soria. And Soria is used interchangeably with Agreda in the sources, because Soria is a town right next to Agreda. And often things that came out of Agreda, because they were printed in Soria, will be just labeled as Soria. So I think that, and Juan is treated, although I haven't found treatises by someone we might actually just simply call Juan of Agreda, he is treated as the great promoter of the Immaculate Conception there in the area, and he has convinced Castillo-Velasco to write this treatise. So I think, although it's merely circumstantial, we have good reason to explore the possibility that Castillo-Velasco is, in fact, one of the principal, if not the principal, source for Maria de Agreda's Scotism. Again, this last bit of information is circumstantial, but I think it is, at the very least, more substantial than the similar sources mentioned by Father Martinez. And it bears further historical research. Thank you very much.
Brother Peter?
The point of view of Father Llamas, the second edition we know of that. It's basically the same as the first, except there's a 55-page appendix with the history of the cause by the Passion, his father, I think of his name, or something like that. Anyway, he's a Passionist. Mm-hmm. Very well written. This is the difficulties that I encounter with these all considerations. After the declaration she was venerable, there seemed to be obstacles every place. Right. One of those in France who was not opposed to it was St. Louis Grignon de Montfort, who did much to promote devotion. He was present at the Sorbonne when the Jansenists and some of the extreme Thomists were opposing, as they were, sometimes for political reasons. And Spaniards, of course, have reason to object to that sort of thing. But I mentioned St. Louis Grignon de Montfort, because he is the first of three very important figures in the church between the end of the Counter-Reformation, so-called, and the beginning of the French Revolution, that kept the spirit of support for the canonization of Mother, but also the effective effort to arrive at a solemn definition of the Immaculate Conception. The two things were bound up together very much. The first figure was St. Louis. The second figure was St. Francis Anthony Fasano, who was totally unknown outside, but a great many of the conventual Franciscan theologians in Italy were strong supporters of, you mentioned a couple, but there's several others, particularly Brancante di Loria.
Yeah, that's right.
He was very important for his opposition in the Holy Office Inquisition.
That's
and his refusal to vote against her, and so he brought ultimately the reversal of the vote by the
right.
Post. But in the meantime, and they thought that they would arrive at a canonization at the time of Benedict the 14th, but it turned out Benedict the 14th wasn't at all favorable. He was sympathetic with all the Jansenists in Italy and left a secret letter saying that if anyone attempted to canonize Mother Mary of Agreda, his letter was to be published. And as it were, a doctrinal statement, which is definitely a purely theological opinion of the Pope, that she was unworthy of. Anyway, Clement the 14th, and who certainly was supported for the cardinal, decided that, among other things, he picked up for the suppression of it. But anyway, he had, for conceding certain things, he would like a little prize from the Spanish king.
Right.
The Spanish king didn't know the story with it. When he was ready, as well, to declare everything was ready for beatification, and then he was going to solemnly define the Immaculate Conception, the Advocatus Diaboli pulled out this stutter no one knew anything about, froze the whole process because Clement the 14th was not ready. So nothing more happened until the time of Blessed Pius IX in the definition. And several very extraordinary miracles were worked through the intercession of in Belgium, of all places. And so the Pope told him, go ahead, I'm ready to do it. You get it already. But unfortunately, he died just before he did it. And the 13th came along, and even though the cardinals voted to continue the process, he said no, forbade any further work. And that's the way it stood until John Paul II. And he told him, if you get the Spanish bishop, if you get the Holy Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith to lift their veto on the he would declare blessed immediately. So they went, and Cardinal Ratzinger was the one. He politely received them, said they would look it over. He looked it over, and said there's no longer any problem with the extraordinary charisms of bilocation. He said, the problem is his Mariology is out of date. Her Mariology is out of date. Of course, meant that St. Bernardine's Mariology, they wouldn't give him the doctorate over and above all Scotus. And he remarked at the end, and the Spanish bishops are still working on it, but he remarked at the end that the three most difficult causes in the beatification were first of Duns Scotus, who represents the learned world in favor of the Immaculate Conception. St. Pius IX, who represents the hierarchy, and the Mother Mary herself. And none of them are complete yet. And all of them were opposed initially because they supported the Immaculate Conception. The opposition came from the Renaissance priests in Cologne, 1474. So it's interesting to see all of the different issues that are involved here. I personally have no trouble with her Scotism, right. Nor do I have any problem with her support of Duns Scotus. Right. There are always limitations on these things, but basically, she did a good job. She wasn't learned herself, but if you leave aside, as Father Llamas says, a certain few sections are relatively small, where the Baroque style is overdone, mm-hmm. or done, but that wasn't resented in those days. That was in style. Her theology, only for a woman of no formal theological training, is extraordinarily good. Yeah, and her support of Codus, the Scotus for the right reasons, is also pretty good. So anyway, those are simply remarks that the Scotus is stopped. Nothing's happening. Can't get the friars to pray for miracles or anything, or other thing. Poor Paul Pius IX, he finally made it to be declared blessed at the time when John Paul II was going to beatify Pius XII and John the 23rd, and they came up with all the new evidence that he was anti-Jewish. John Paul II said, okay, we'll investigate it more. In the meantime, we'll substitute Pius IX for Pius XII. And then the screams went up, we have to believe the syllabus. The syllabus, he said, you can do what you want with it, but you had to, you didn't want Pius XII, so I want Pius IX, and that's the way we're going to do it.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I can add one little thing to that. Monsignor Antonio Piolanti was a great Thomist, but also, I think, more broad-minded than a number of them. He was the postulator of the cause of Pius IX for years, and they had the miracle on ice for about 9 years or so. Yeah. They just didn't dare, because the Italian bishops didn't want him, because he was the last Pope King. But a question I wanted to ask was, you've concentrated on these first moments.
Yeah, that's right.
Are there other indications of Scotism in her writings?
I should say very quickly, I feel myself fairly new to studying Sor Maria, and I actually came to this a bit indirectly, looking at biblical commentaries in Spain in this time period, and of course I've done a little work on the history of Baroque Scotism. These, I think, are the most obvious cases, at least pertaining to this issue, because she's clearly using a refined scholastic vocabulary, and she's using it correctly. And it's interesting because many folks, besides the tenor of the book, Father Carroll, for example, he'll say that she implies a position, but doesn't state a position that Mary is absolutely free of any debt of sin. I actually think that she states it, but in passing. So you see other things that are clearly quickly becoming solidified as the Scotus position. Because when you, before the great debates at Sevilla and Toledo in the second decade of the 17th century, at that point, there, I mean, as Castillo Velasco himself says, there are Scotists that support a debitum proximum. There are Scotists that, kind of old Scotists that will still hold this position. There are many that support a remote debt to Adam. But it's only right around this time, and actually Castillo Velasco is one of the few that will say, no, it's either a truly personal debt, and that she's included under the headship of Adam, but she is dispensed from the punishment due to the law, or there's no debt whatsoever. She has no relation to the sin of Adam. She does not fall under the debitum peccati of Adam, but rather the debitum gratiae of Christ himself. And that's becoming a almost a solidified Franciscan position right here about 1640. And Castillo Velasco is one of the first that starts really doubling down on that, because he's starting to divide the Scotus up. And real quickly, the Italian and the Spanish Scotus are going to take what we now consider to be the view of the absolute primacy and predestination of Mary. Whereas before, they're a lot of them are influenced by Suarez, whose own views change over time, and they have many different positions. But it's here, especially with Castillo Velasco in this generation, that they're starting to double down. So you see a little bit of that. But you know, it's funny. I wouldn't consider myself a scholar of the text itself. When you mention it, I mean, the place to look at, and here maybe, Father, you can answer the question. If you know the answer, I suspect that if you were to see traces, I mean, it depends upon what she may have read. I mean, I'm inclined to think that she at least glanced at this commentary. I mean, she knows Latin, or at least Fun Mayor and Monero both say that she did. Maybe you could find it in some Scotistic sacramental theology, but I haven't seen anything that immediately jumps out at me. But again, I wouldn't consider myself truly familiar with the text. Mm-hmm. I focused on the first book because that touches upon some of the stuff that I've already done with absolute predestination of Christ and Mary. But there it's quite apparent. I mean, I couldn't imagine that she wasn't familiar with some sources. And let me say very quickly, I don't think that takes anything away from her visions at all.
Mm-hmm. And well, you would expect that she would have heard a lot of Franciscan preachers, too.
Oh yeah, without a doubt. And they're preaching on Mary's freedom from any debt of sin, and it's been the dominant issue in Spain for 20 years. I mean, I always say, imagine, you know, we have to keep in mind that for Philip III and IV, they wanted to make it as national policy to the glory of Spain, the definition of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. You can only imagine our own political sphere if both parties had to compete for the definition of a dogma in the church. Now this, just imagine the difference in worlds. Because this is what's there at going on at Spain, and everything is being presented in those terms. So, without a doubt, I think a lot of
I think they call that the vow of blood, didn't they?
Well, that was very big. I mean, and of course, going all the way into Italy, as well, it was very big.
Father Peter, are you aware of any other Scotistic influences in the mystical city?
I can't recall everything offhand, but there are certainly a lot of Scotus in the mystical city of God. It's like one I was impressed when I was doing the translation of Father Llamas's work, or whole sections taken from the mystical. But I checked it with the old translation, which is fairly well done. As far as I can see, for instance, her presentation of absolute primacy, and then more importantly, importantly, the theory of the hypostatic union of Scotus is very accurate.
Yeah, that's no, right.
There were major positions of Scotus which were perfectly formulated. Even if she knew Latin, she didn't know it. Have any training in the use of Latin and theology, the technical use, and to come out making no mistakes all by yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
I never. But I think it's also true, with all their defects, that the Scotists of the 17th and even the 18th century were quite competent as scholars. And they were very perceptive of what were the real motivations of opposition to the dogmatic definition of the Immaculate Conception. And one person is exceptional. I don't know if I forgot it. The three figures I think are the greatest, most important, all had marvelous practical expositions of the meaning of the Immaculate Conception, in particular Francis Anthony Fasani of the Conventuals, and so brings the history of the tradition, the first page, almost to its conclusion, because after him there is no great advocate of Immaculate Conception until after the definition. There were some excellent theologians of all the Franciscan families who helped the Pope to formulate, but they're not great figures in theology or spirituality. And the third figure is Father St. Alphonsus de Liguori.
Right.
Well, these are the three great Marian figures, and they clearly, all three of them supported the canonization of Maria de Agreda.
Yeah, when I look at the Baroque sources, just to concur, as late as the 1720s and 1730s, the production of Mariology is probably at its height with Del Moral, whom Father Martinez mentions, and much more rarely, although a work, of course, championed by Father Carroll, the great three-volume Mariology of Salvador Montalbanus.
Yeah,
The
biggest Mariologies were the Spanish, but there were some Italian ones.
Without a doubt.
For the money.
Without a doubt.
Some ways, as it were, more balanced presentations. And then there were just a single one-volume theses on Our Lady. There were many of the Jesuits produced them as well.
Any other questions, comments?
Trent and I.
Let's move on.
I just wanted to know. You said you think the opposition was mostly over the Scotus position or the support for the Immaculate Conception. Were there any other issues?
Well, I think that's the first chapter. You know, that's the first move, but it comes very quickly to embrace a very wide range of theological issues that I would like to continue to explore and kind of hint to actually in the title, which is a little bit of false advertisement, is that it actually, one of the things that I find fascinating here is that the critics, and this is especially of the French critics, and they're not all Jansenists, but they all share a broadly, let's say, humanist bent. They want to question the historical veracity of the visions. So, ironically, in the Catholic Church, you will get a far kind of what looks like the development of something that looks like historical biblical criticism, not with regards to the Bible itself at this era, which is the height of mystical commentaries. So following, I did not know that this was in St. Bonaventure until you mentioned it, Father, but in Spain they put into practice this thought that the entire scripture from Genesis to Apocalypse is about Christ and Mary and the Holy Eucharist. So it's a great era of mystical commentaries on scripture, and they are voluminous in the best Baroque manner, and there is nothing lacking in them. But it's actually, of course, Eusebius Amor and the historical critics that will not attack scripture itself, but will attack the visions for not being historical. Yeah. And whereas the Dominicans, they want to argue against the definability of the
doctrine or the dogma of the Immaculate Conception, because I want to say you cannot define a dogma based upon an argument ex conveniencia, because theology must be a science of conclusions. It must be deductive. Now, at this point, they've doubled down. They've adopted the Rondus and Gregory of Rimini's positions on theology as a science. And it's only in the 1920s and 30s, of course, with Chenut and Congar, that the Dominicans will let go of that position. And they hold it for so long that theology has to be a science of conclusions, precisely to define, to deny the definability of the doctrine of the, or the dogma of the Immaculate Conception. Yes. They will say, no, it doesn't matter if you make us teach it. It can never be defined as dogma because it's not a true conclusion. It's not a syllogistic conclusion. And it, of course, even after Ineffabilis Deus, you would think that they might drop the science, theology as a deductive science, but they don't. They actually double down, but then are forced to accept what the Franciscans have been saying for quite some time, namely that the literal meaning of Proverbs 8:22 is Christ and Mary. Mm. Not the spiritual meaning, the literal meaning. The literal meaning of Genesis 3:15 is the world decreed immaculately, Christ, Mary, the holy mountain, you know, and such. So the Franciscans have been saying for years that those are the literal meanings of Scripture. Mm. And ironically, that even the development of modern biblical Catholic hermeneutics, like the census plenary and all that, it grows out of that conflicts here. The emphasis on the historical criticism of the visions, not the Bible, and then theology as a science. So oddly, the cooperation of Thomas and Jansenus for different reasons is going to, I kind of produce an explosion that self-combusts and cannot, obviously can't carry on after the dogma is actually defined.
One of the first Jansen is John Lannoy.
That's right.
Yeah, John Lannoy. Yeah, he tried to, he was the major critic of the Sabbatine Bull, even though eight popes established it as, approved it as authentic.
Yeah, and then, it'll... it'll be picked up by Muratori and critical tradition. Yeah. No, that's exactly right. I mean, this is kind of, in some sense, the first chapter. What I have here in my mind, what I have here is kind of the criticisms of Bianchi, the first Dominican censor, who will say the whole work is infected by Scotism. This entire work. I mean, he thinks it's the entire work, todo libro. But now, obviously, a little exaggerated, but a lot of it is scotistic. He's right about that, but he thinks that that's reason, to deny it. And of course you read the censors' accounts, and they'll say, as if the, as if the Virgin would teach Scotism. Actually, I don't know if y'all know this, but Carl Rahner, in his book on private revelation, it was a book and then put in published with other things in translation. Of course, he's dealing with a bad translation of Sor Maria, so he I think makes a mistake about her own writing, but he does not hesitate to point out that Saint Catherine of Siena also says the Virgin told her that she was not immaculately conceived. And the Dominicans did not complain about that afterwards. So Karl Rahner actually comes to the defense, and he's talking about that issue.
I don't know whether I dare just mention this briefly. I'm sure that she's very worth studying. And I did a little study years ago on St. Joseph, and I quoted from St. Bridget of Sweden and Catherine Emmerich. I didn't go to Mary of Agreda. But it is interesting that these who have given us lives of Mary and Christ don't always agree on matters.
Yeah,
and
right.
They're edifying. And I think they're of value. I don't think they should be written away, but they are not the gospel. So we can get insights from them. I remember Father Curler, who was at the Marian Research Institute for years, giving a paper at the Mariological Congress in Zaragoza. and Saragossa, Spain, on such figures, and his rather clever conclusion without dealing with the reality was, the meditations at the end of every chapter are very edifying, without really dealing with the more theological issues.
Well, I mean, one thing that would be interesting there, and I don't know this literature as well, is, of course, we know that she wrote her own spiritual exercises, and they were later, you know, published at the press that was whose money was used to support her canonization, which published many of the great Scotistic works in the 18th century. But one thing that would be interesting would be to compare the spiritual writings to other Franciscan mystical writings on mental prayer and such at the time, to see the degree to which there might be influence of either her directors or important books there. I don't know that literature as well, but, well, there's a lot of it in Spain, and, you know, I suspect you could find a lot of it, you know, right here in Agreda or Soria or Zaragoza, you know.
Mm-hmm. I think I must correct myself. I think he was talking about Benoit Roncourel, who I think has since been beatified. She was the visionary at this place in France, which was only accepted about 300 years after... L-A-U-S.
No.
And Benoit Tranquil, I think she's now venerable. Maybe so.
I'm conscious that we've gone about an hour, and I'm wondering, is there any other question, Chris, you want to
I do want to bring it up because I think it's important, because Trent was fascinated when I brought it up, and I know Father Peter has read, because I always submit everything to him,
sure.
Is how fascinating it is that the Scotus came to the same position as authentic Orthodox theology, which is Gregory Nazianzen sees that the baptism of Jesus is his purification, and hence the patristic tradition culminating in Simeon of Thessalonica in the 1400s is that the sacraments are established for the perfect nature, and that there are the first three sacraments, baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist, and those are sacraments for Jesus and Mary. And those are sacraments for the all-pure nature, and that authentic marriage is actually virginity, which is productive, which is the virgin, and then it's only fallen marriage, which is, you know, copulation, this sort of thing. And then you have you only have the conditional sacraments that are based off of the fall. And so you have something like what you're talking about here, which is the logical reduction of, or possibility, from an immaculate universe, which is the sacraments are about participation in Christ.
Yeah, and one thing, there's strangely, even in England, in Hopkins' day, they're familiar with the Baroque sources that will sometimes discuss which sacraments would exist in Eden. And of course, they tend to follow the patristic models. So that's a tradition that's quite broad. When we were talking about it earlier, I'd forgotten it, because Grossetest, I think, is one who mentions this. He certainly talks about the possibility of an Edenic Eucharist. And there's a sense in which, with these more mystical interpretations of scripture in Spain at this time, you see the full array of kind of explorations of that topic. And every now and then you see it, you'll see it in the theological treatises. But usually with the sense of, in discussions of an immaculate world and what a world would look like without the fall, whether there would still be the Eucharist. And some the Jesuits especially take a fascination with this for different reasons, but the Franciscans also follow that tradition.
Thank you.
I think we can give our... Oh, did you want to say something, Father Peter?
I'm finished.
Okay. We would like to say thank you to Trent for this.
Thank you.